So I have Office 365 groups now. I thought that I'd just go through as a walkthrough and explore this as I go. So let's just see what we can do. We've got this new panel of groups along the left-hand side. It seems to have collapsed all our folders now into a new pane, which we have to click more to go and see the additional folders we might have within our mailbox. So get used to being able to switch backwards and forwards between groups, folders, people, etc. We'll go and click on the folders back button to get back into our main I don't know, menu along the side. So we've got the people area that we most common people that has been around for a few months now. Groups, right? So create a new group. Let's try this out. So get a panel up onto the side. I'll try and be a bit more original than just putting in test. Let's put in OneNote fans. So I'm not sure what this area is. I mean, it's creating the group ID as OneNote fans just based on what I've put in. So that's fine. Maybe I've got the opportunity to rename what this is all about. I think maybe it's the underlying ID that is used for the email address and every other bits and pieces underneath it, and that this might just be the title. Add a description. It is what it is. Notable fans. I've got the option to change it to a public or private group. So I've heard that at this point, if you make a choice to make it start as private, make public, you can't go backwards. Don't know yet. We'll see what we discover. We'll subscribe members so that they can get those conversations in their inbox. And what else do we get as we create the group? So to navigate to your group, you move between the shared conversations and documents. Okay, we can add members at the moment, so I'll add some of my traditional test users: Jack Sparrow, Elizabeth Swan. Oh no, she's not there. That's funny. Oh well, it doesn't seem to be resolving that one. We'll just stick with Jack for now. Add Jack. And so now we have a pretty standard two acronyms or two letters to represent the group name and something of a landing page within our group. So this is purely browser-based. We're not going to see this or experience this within our Outlook client. What have we got here? So there's a conversation thread, and we're getting a preview pane at the bottom of this area, body of the group, and a default conversation that's been created at the start, at the top. So we'll just create something up here. New conversation. These groups look interesting. And send. Okay, so we've got an alert immediately to say there's a new conversation. We're getting these delivered and being told about it when it happens. We'll click on here, and I like that we've got this reply all button. We don't have reply and forward and all those sorts of things. It's a conversation that some bright cookie described as it's working out loud. There is only reply all. So we'll see what happens. Oh, looks like we can add or reply to specifically a person and a group. Nothing imaginative there for text. And so we're seeing how that thread has been built out. I can see the topic of the conversation, and I can see it's got one reply. I don't see a tree of replies, so perhaps what I'll do is I'll just pause. We'll log in as Jack Sparrow in another session and get some conversation banter going between. Right, logged in as Jack, and I've been kindly subscribed by the group owner. So now I also see the OneNote fans in my groups panel. We'll just visit that. But before we do that, let's also see some of the messages that have been sent through. So because I've been subscribed, Jack gets this new conversation message, right? We also get, you've been added to this group. So something of a, that was from a previous attempt. A message to say that this is what the group is. It's called Test. So this was before this video, but probably expect to see a similar conversation in here for OneNote fans. No, so maybe we just get that message when we have first added to groups. Or maybe that's still coming on through. But we've got a thread there. This is where we're able to view our thread. So we're within our email messages, we get a nice threaded view like we do see within conversation view within Outlook. But if we visit the group as Jack, then okay, we're seeing a slightly different configuration of the layout. We get an introduction, we get the conversation on the left hand side or the middle pane, and then we can see the thread of conversation. We'll just see what happens as I'm replying to that. Nothing exciting to say there. Okay, so that just drops my conversation in, adds me to the thread. And so you see the thread, if I was to refresh that screen, what I'm interested in is the most recent conversation going to be at the top, or do we need to continue to scroll down to the bottom to see the most recent reply? And I just want to see if refreshing the screen will present that differently. And does that present it? Nope. So it looks like with this reply that I've created, it's replying to ASDF, and we'll go down the list to see the most recent reply. If we were to flick back to our email view folder, it has the conversation view again, and we'll see my reply at the top of the list. So that's a different experience to actually being inside the group. What other buttons do we have available here? So, well, I can forward and I can show some details about the message. What can I do to other people's messages? Okay, so that's just a few things about that. Now I just want to explore why I'm getting a different layout compared to what I get when I'm here logged in as myself. Is there a way that I can adjust this group to show a different layout? And maybe it's up here that might be able to change the layout. Now that's also going to be probably affecting all of my conversations. Let me just pause so you don't have to wait and see me try and explore it, and we'll come back with the answer. Well, I can't really see an obvious way of how to change the layout from having a middle column and the preview on the side. It's been so long since I've done that for just standard Outlook web access that I've forgotten how to do that too. So never mind, let's just get on with looking at this. So we've got our conversation threads in two different ways. We can see it as this or as Jack Sparrow's layout, which was our preview pane. So we've got a preview pane on the left. Now one thing I did find interesting too was as I was poking around under our ellipsis button, so we get to see the different things we can do within a group. I'll get into that soon. But I did bump into the view details. And so remember when I created my group, I had an opportunity to give it a title, OneNote Fans, and then also a group ID, which becomes the address for the group. One thing to note that it is using the .on Microsoft address. Some of us found that kind of interesting. We expected it to show the primary address. For my case, it would be webster.net.nz. We'll probably learn a bit more about that later too. So from that, that's more like your contact card that you get when you're working with Link or within Outlook. That you also have a contact card for your OneNote fans, or your group rather. So we'll just have a look too at some of the other options of editing the group. So we can go in and change the title, we can give it an image as well. So I'll just try and find something appropriate to use as an image. Let's have a look-see. go into my logos and find my OneNote fans. Great new group cooler, yeah, OneNote water cooler Yammer group that we've got going now. So that'll upload the image. I've heard that this sort of adheres to the standard contact image that you have with an exchange of 200 by 200. But I've actually just uploaded something that I know for a fact is a slightly larger dimension, and I've got a nicer resolution. So, yeah, go figure. At this point too, I could delete the group, so if you want to get rid of it, that's where you go ahead and do it, and make it public or not. So I could allow people outside the organisation to email it, just like I can with a shared mailbox, and allow mail to come to it. Alright, so those are some of the options. We'll save that and have a look at some other things that we can do with this group. So we get an updated logo. Sorry, it's a PNG, so it's got that transparency thing going on there. And we've started a new group conversation. So I want to see I can specifically add additional people. Let's just add in Jack. Alright, so it is like an email. I can email OneNote fans as the distribution list, in a sense, or the address for the shared mailbox, but I can hook in people that may or may not be part of the group. Let's have a look. We couldn't add Elizabeth Swan earlier, but maybe I've deleted her account. Who else can we pick on? Captain Barbosa? Barbosa. Who's in my directory? I mean, surely this should be based on my directory, so we do try Elizabeth Swan, contacts and directory. Oh, there it is, it's just not resolving for some reason. No worries. So I could have added Elizabeth Swan by doing that. Never mind. So a new message, added Elizabeth and welcome her. And that's simple enough. So that, as I see within the group experience, if we scroll on down to the bottom of the list, no, that's a new conversation. We'll click the new conversation and then we'll see the thread from here. Let's see what it looks like when Jack replies to that conversation. He sees an alert there saying new activity. So it's not going to refresh dynamically for him. He needs to click new activity and see what that conversation might be. So it appears as I would expect a new conversation, there we go, in the middle column, and he can click into that new conversation and begin to participate in it. And there we go, we've looped in various people. I could add other people within my organization there, but we'll just reply to all. Jack's got a lot to say this morning. Send that, and we should see a few pings and bing bongs as it appears. So there's two experiences I'm seeing that you can go into the group and reply from there. I might find the email view a little more useful in terms of seeing the most recent reply at the top of the conversation thread. That's just me. But from here, let's have a look at other options I can do with this message. I can forward it, I can show details and reply. So that's fine. Okay, so what else can we do as a member of the group? I can go into calendar and get a nice standard view of what the calendar is. And so that's overlaying my own calendar with an Outlook Web Access, overlaying in green the group's calendar that I belong to. And as a group, I know that I'm working within that calendar because it's bolded, and my own Outlook calendar is faded in the background. I'll just add an event and we'll say morning tea for Elizabeth. Sort of a welcome morning tea. Okay, here's the thing. I thought that I was working in my calendar because it's bolded. I'm creating that event, and it's actually creating it within my calendar rather than the group calendar. So let's just swap that over and make sure. Morning tea. It seems like it's going to be an all-day event. No worries. That's okay, and that has also not just added that to my group calendar, but it's also added it to my personal calendar. So just for interest's sake, let's see what happens if I just went with the default behavior clicked into the event. And let's make this more than the month view. Let's put it into a work week. Okay, we're bolded. We're in our group calendar, but let's make it another event. Morning tea. Ugh. Let's just ignore spelling errors this morning, or whatever time of the world you are at. And I don't expect that to appear in my group calendar because I'm working in my personal calendar. That's fine. Let's try another one. Click over and say add that into my group calendar. And okay, so it's added it to there. And I expect it to duplicate again, perhaps. So that I've got two events. Nothing yet. Okay, we'll come back to that. That's how it appeared to work within our group calendar when we created that first event of morning tea. You might have picked up on something I did a little differently there as I was creating it. So that's our group calendar. And, well, do we get any other options here? Group calendar, well, that's how we navigate between all various things. Just really, it's just standard calendar within Outlook. I noticed too that our picture hasn't upgraded yet, so it takes a little while perhaps for that picture to come through. Right click over here. Alright, so maybe this is an opportunity to look at what we can do if we belong to a lot of groups. So you might have 50 or 60 groups or that you're belonging to. You can add it to your favourites. What is a group favourite? We can colour this in our calendar. We'll add to favourites. And if we go to groups, I saw this on the screen beforehand. More. Okay, so more tells you more about your groups. Here's the groups that you belong to, and I just happen to have favorited one, so it's moved it from my joined groups to my favorite groups. And I can browse for groups. Now there's not going to be too many groups there to browse, but all groups. So that becomes a I guess a view of the global address list and all the groups that are available. So if there was a couple more, I could say, oh, that looks interesting, I'll subscribe to that and join that, if that's the setting that is available, that I can join it. So directory, now I'm in all groups. Is there a way of getting back to that previous screen? Probably just by clicking OneNote Fans. You see actually that the view that I'm in now, I've switched over from being in calendar to people. So I can now see the groups, or the people, the members of the groups. So I'm switching quite seamlessly between the different experiences within Exchange. I can go between calendar, I can go into people, and then our conversation view, which in the background is a shared mailbox and used in quite a clever way. Let's have a look. It's basically, if I wanted to go back to those different areas of conversations or calendar, then I'm going to see those views as I click between. I now see groups within each of those views. Now as I've clicked back there, it's remembered the position that I was in my calendar, looking a little closer at groups. So that's interesting. It doesn't refresh that. We'll go back to groups and see our calendars. So that's enough of calendars there. I can single that out, turn the overlay on and off, but I want to get back into seeing a bit more about what else groups can do. So I've got that little two that was briefly there saying that there's a couple of new messages there. Okay, so the invites that we created while we were in the calendar are now appearing as messages within the group messaging. Makes sense. So I now have the opportunity to go, right, I'm going to go along to the morning tea for Elizabeth. And that has been added to my calendar. Let's see if that has appeared there. Oh, it is actually warning me so that is the case. And that's because it's an all-day event. So a morning tea started at the very early morning hour of 12 o'clock in the morning. But that's the simple way of getting that event into your own calendar. Not sure what was happening there with the behaviour beforehand when I created the event and it just appeared there, but that's something we'll discover as we play a bit more. Do we have the same option for add to calendar? Yes, we do. Okay, so our conversations become more than just talk, in terms of I'm talking about this, I'm asking a question, I'm making an announcement. They also pull together the new events that have been announced within the group. So that's really good. It means that there's one place to check and keep up to date with things. That's our view of it within the group view. Let's go back over to our inbox and we should see, I would expect to see an invite or two in here to go to the to subscribe to that event or to add it to our calendar, but I don't. Now there's that message that I expected to see a little earlier about the welcome message to the group that Jack had been subscribed about 20 minutes ago, and that's his introduction to it and inviting you to come on in and participate. Okay, so we'll get back into our group again and explore a few more features. We've got files. So just like within SharePoint Online, that we have the ellipses menu, and like dot 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 means there's more to see, more actions to explore. We get a couple of group functions and places to explore, and then everything else is underneath the ellipses menu. So we've looked at conversations, we've looked at calendar, we've looked at members by bumping into it from the people view. So this could get quite full as far as views go. Oh, thank you, yes, I'm missing the morning team. Maybe I better just dismiss them all. And go into frequent view, we go to just display name. So some people, no, I was expecting to perhaps see a different view, a list view. Display name and frequent contacts, I guess that makes sense. So it's tiled out, there doesn't seem to be a list view where you can just scroll through and perhaps have them in alphabetical order. Doesn't seem to be in order either. Maybe that first the order of this, it's showing you as the member first in the group and then anyone else following that. We're not seeing Elizabeth because we haven't added her, so let's just add Elizabeth in now that we know we can do so. So it's not resolving from the search, active search directory. Okay, well, we can do that, that's good. Add her, newly added members. Alright, we have added her, and whoop, cancel. So was it enough to just click and say yep, I want to add her? Okay, so we have put her in the list that we're going to add, and perhaps she isn't added until we click the save button. Let's see if that refreshes our people list or the members of the group, and yay, good. Must update her picture. I'm pretty sure it had another Lego picture there to reflect who Elizabeth Swann is. You can tell what I'm a fan of, Pirates of the Caribbean. So we've got our people view, and there's probably not much more that we can do to explore in here. We can see admins or just all members. Wouldn't mind seeing the details view there of being able to list and just scroll through. So let's have a look now at the other way to navigate around our group features, calendar, members, files. And it opens a separate tab. So it looks like we're now leaving the Outlook experience. And rightly so, it is going over to a SharePoint feature, SharePoint service, and so we are going outside of Exchange. So it's not a Outlook web access experience now, but it is integrated. We will see this. The integration, or the way of being able to navigate around, is consistent. So we still have our ellipses menu, and we can flick backwards and forwards between the different services to do with our group. So now we're seeing a familiar look, similar to OneDrive for Business. And what we've heard is that we do get our terabyte of storage. Ooh, no, hang on, let's back that up. We do could have up to a terabyte of storage, but the storage is assigned dynamically from the pool of storage that we have available for our whole tenant. So maximum of a terabyte, it does come out of your pool of storage that you've either earned at sign up or have added via your subscription. So OneDrive for Business, let's have a look. We could add a new file. Yeah, let's create a Word document just on the fly so we're familiar with that kind of experience. Something that some of us might not have bumped into yet, so it's a good opportunity to say so. As we create our document, we can rename it by just double clicking on the title of it up there. New doc. I'm getting less and less imaginative. It's pulled across my theming, that black bar that I had. I can use that as a breadcrumb to get back to storage. Nothing really to click up here, and of course the familiar experience of Word Online. Can I share from this experience? Oh, now here we go. The consistent experience of when we're within Office Online, we have our Yammer conversation panel. So don't know what's coming in the future. Maybe we'll see a conversation panel there that will be unified as far as Yammer and Office 365 groups is concerned. I would have expected perhaps to see a conversation panel, if anything, relating back to our Office 365 groups. But never mind. It is early days and there are some good things still coming. Not a lot much more to see, but what's the share option? Probably just giving us our standard, yes. Invite people to it, share it with. We don't have our get a link button. We might see that somewhere else. Don't know. But if we're turned on the ability to share the files with the public, as in inviting people in from the public, a external user perhaps, I'd expect that option there. So maybe this is confirming to me that external people can participate in groups, but only in terms of email conversations, that we can't invite people in perhaps to share files. We'll dig around a bit more and find out. But that's our standard, drop in the email address, assign the permission to see what they can do, message, whether you email it or not, that sort of thing. Pretty standard. So let's get back to our file experience, because we know what a document's like. Can I find anything safe that I could drag over? That's still ticking away there, loading. Perhaps this is a good old New Zealand bandwidth thing, or maybe I'm competing with the rest of my family in the household. So on another screen here, I'm just looking for another document to drag over and drop into the file storage. Perhaps while that's ticking away and we're waiting for the bandwidth to be freed up in our household. So I've gone back to looking at... Oh, there we go, it's finished up. File storage. Not seen any image there of the groups yet. Not sure why it's doubled up. But I'll drag over my picture, or rather a document. Something small enough. Yeah. SharePoint for Power Users Online. Let's have a look at that. Ooh! Folders and invalid files can't be dragged to upload. So I've just tried to drag over a PDF. Let's see if I can do that again and have a image that is recognizable. PDF image. So we know it's a PDF document. We're dropping it on the library. So file storage for groups doesn't like PDFs. Find that hard to believe. Let's try and upload it manually. Grab the address from OneDrive for Business to make it easier. And that. Oh, I know what it is. The document I'm trying to drag over is currently set to online only. I haven't opened it up locally on my machine, so it has to download. So please disregard that experience. Let's see if it can come across now. Now that I've downloaded it from OneDrive Consumer, drag, drop, voila. So that message was semi-intelligent. It was saying that you can't drag it over because it's not downloaded, but yeah, the message really didn't give us a clue there. That's just one thing about selective syncing with OneDrive Consumer. So yes, files for groups can receive PDF files. I definitely hope so. So we can choose to manually upload. We know about creating new documents. Anything else that we can do there? Well, we do see that our SharePoint experience of being able to add columns. Let's see if we can do site contents. Site settings. So some typical site settings there. Yeah, there's a few things we could play with. Let's see if we can change the look and feel. We don't have any themes. Top link bar, tree view, quick launch. Let's not play with those then. You might be able to set your regional settings for your group, which may make sense if your group is based in one location. Seems to be defaulting to Pacific time, so that's something to be mindful of, that it's a brand new site collection for this group and file storage. One of our first steps should be to go and make sure that it's the correct time or time zone, and perhaps your English or locale. So we'll expect to see a refresh there, and we'll stick with that. So SharePoint people will know to poke around in there and do that. Those of us who don't and are just trying to provision a space for us to work probably won't know to go in there and change those settings. So we'll need to make a note of that and let people know about that. Let's see if we can manage some site features and turn a few things on. Can we turn on announcements tiles? We've seen a lot of things here that you would normally see in SharePoint. And I won't bore you with that. Let's just explore that some other time. But we'll go back to what I want to see is site contents for our file storage. How about that? Maybe we can create ourselves another library. You know what? Looking at our address bar, we've just gone away to the OneDrive for Jack. So we're now just looking at our OneDrive experience, and we can add additional libraries and bits and pieces in there. That's no issue. Maybe those site settings were just specific to our OneDrive experience and not to our group. Let's go back a few paces. Here's a point. So we're now in this view and this experience. How do we get back to our groups? Maybe we'll just go back to OneDrive and see if we can access our groups from there. Maybe we'll see. Yes, we do. So within OneDrive, we have access to our own documents. That's great. And a panel there, just like within Outlook Web Access and that experience, that we can go into our groups. I'm going to visit both of these groups just out of interest. Oh, they've consolidated now. That's good. So there's a few things that might take a little while to catch up. Oh, it's come back again. Alright, so that means that anything that we do up here as far as site contents is concerned, it's all about my OneDrive for Business. Nothing to do with the group. Enough exploring there. So we can't add additional columns, maybe. We just adjust the modified date and time. In a SharePoint world, we'd be able to go up to a ribbon and see the different options of being able to work with files and work with the library itself. So we don't see those options. Maybe they're hidden away somewhere, and there might be a way of accessing them, but I won't play around with that. Something to note, even though I'm seeing two groups here, both of them appear to be selected. So if I click in the second group, and it'll load up and probably give me the same view and have them both selected. Alright, So we've explored the different areas as a user, a non-admin for the group. We've seen conversations, calendar, we've looked at members and files, and now do I try the leave option? I'm picking that means I'm going to leave the group. Does it warn me? No, it doesn't. So if I just choose conversations, that seems to load up Outlook Web Access again, which we've already got open in another tab. I'll just close that. And we're back to our view of conversations. Great. Oh, and see the icon, it reflects the group is inviting you to a calendar. So we've had a good look at what appears to be on the surface things that a user will experience. Looks like we can reply to an event too. I intend to come. Can start a conversation around the meeting itself. That could be useful. But we'll now have a look at the administrator's options. Get my screens all mixed up. There we go. See what we can do as an admin. So again, there's a whole lot of activity that's happened while we've been looking from Jack's point of view, and we need to refresh to see those conversations. So I do really want to dig in and find out how to change this layout, because I do favour the column in the middle and with conversations and preview pane out to the right. But let's have a look at what else an admin can do. That of course, I guess, is really just what we looked at earlier. As an admin, I can edit groups, and I'm sure there was an option somewhere around here to make people an admin as well. I want to perhaps elevate Jack to be able to help me administer the group. So I think maybe we'll see that from our people view. Let's do that. Go over to members, and I'm not seeing Jack there anymore. Interesting. Oh, okay. So when I did leave the group in Jack's view, and I'd clicked up here and said leave, it didn't tell me that I'd left. Just refreshed the screen, and still made me feel like I was in the group. But I did leave. Maybe if I refresh this now, we'll see whether or not I am in the group. I can still view the group, and because it's a public group, I expect that. But it has finally called up, and it's given me the option to join the group. So I can browse a group, and if it's a public group, see the content and what's going on, and then choose to join. I'll do that again. Because I do want to see if, once I've joined the group, good, I'm now a member again, I'm not feeling like I'm missing out on all the things that are going on with OneNote fans. I'll refresh the page, and I want to see if I can elevate Jack to being an admin. I'm pretty sure that I'll be able to do this from our people view. So we get our ellipsis button if we hover over Jack. Make it admin! Hoorah! Promoting. Promoted to admin, great. Pretty straightforward. Jack's an admin. Now that Jack's an admin, Jack should be able to see a little more than just the standard options. As an admin, maybe that's going to change his layout. Let's have a look. No. But he does now have the option to edit the group. And that's what you would expect if you were an admin, that you can do so. So we have had a good look. It's been a long video. I'll try and chop out a few things to shorten it up. We've looked at just the basic user experience. I've tried to explore things and give you an honest experience of someone who hasn't used groups before, and you know, what do we do with them, how do we use them, and what do we bump into. perhaps some of the delights and some of the challenges. But hopefully this has been helpful, and thank you very much for watching.